Wane wachenelo ate omakelayo Wane wachenelo ate omakelayo Wane wachenelo ate omakelayo
All right, you guys, we're doing this workshop again, part two of the Indigenous Entrepreneurship Workshop. My name is Nathan Ayres from iops.ca, striving to become the number one Indigenous job board in Canada. And partnered up today with Chief Saskatchewan Indian Equity Foundation and also with Futurepreneur. And they're going to be doing presentation today. So if you guys can, you can check this out on YouTube. We're live on YouTube if you want to put it on your TV. We're also live on Facebook if you're wherever you're watching it from. Also on LinkedIn. So there you guys go. Check us out and stay tuned. We're going to have, what do we got going on here? We got Futurepreneur Trade Show and a Futurepreneur. They're going to do a couple more slides. But if you guys are wanting to know how to start a business and what avenues to take to get funding, to go through some grants and all that stuff, maybe doing a business plan, Noah Wilson from Futurepreneur is one of the guys that will be helping you. As you guys can see him on this screen right here, he's getting ready to do a presentation. So if there's any questions, you guys do have any questions, put them in the comments and I will literally ask him and he will answer you guys live. So that's how cool we are. I'm just getting ready. So if you guys can do me a favor right now and share this wherever you are watching, share it to everybody, get them on here, and let's get more Indigenous people out there doing living their dream of if they want to become an entrepreneur. And that's what it's all about. It's all about us connecting like that and getting Indigenous people to that have that spark and that fire in them to create their own business, to get out there and connect with all these organizations that are there to help us. So so if you guys can do that, share this away. We're getting Noah on the left there to help us out. Sorry, I'm just sharing it myself, but I'm going to go back to Noah.
Validation maps. All right. So the validation maps are the documents, the four quadrant documents that you should all have in your packages. If you're joining us virtual and you didn't have an opportunity to register with CIEF beforehand, just get a blank piece of paper, fold it hot dog, fold it hamburger, or just create four quadrants. We'll help you in terms of setting it up. That's all you need. It's a powerful tool. You know, some of the most powerful, effective tools on earth are simple, right? So this is one of those tools. So we're going to be focusing on the validation map today. And really, this is about alignment. This is about validating your business idea. Is there alignment between, you know, the four key areas that you really need to think about and start prepping for before you even get started on your business plan? So what's going to happen today is you're going to have essentially the starting point for your business plan going into it. So you're not leaving. We're not only are we connecting with other amazing Indigenous. I've seen, you know, what the beautiful part about today is cross collaboration. I hear, you know, individuals talking about their background. They're working with youth that could, you know, collaborate with, equine therapy. Like this, it's about the connections. It's about the Indigenous entrepreneurial ecosystem that we're building, and all of you are helping do that for the next generation and inspiring the next folks to who are going to kind of walk in the path that you're all trailblazing right now. So validation map, let's get that started. And I'll just mention again, like there is an article, there's a neuroscientist that was studying about goal setting and you know, the more that you put down on paper, the fact that you're all writing down, the fact that you're in here today and starting to write things down, you're exponentially more likely to follow through on that than if it was just up here and you're not putting down on paper. So just remember that today, okay?
That's what we're accomplishing.
So the validation map. So you'll notice the validation map for everyone online. The validation map is broken down into four quadrants that all need to align for your business model or for your business model to really be able to be successful in the long run. If we can articulate these four areas, there's a good chance that you're at a good starting point in terms of fleshing out the key aspects of your business before you start a business plan. We're in the ideation stage, or even if you've started a business, you've been operating, this is an excellent exercise. You know, every, you know, 3 years, most businesses have to do strat planning. So these can change, you know, businesses evolve. I just had dinner with an entrepreneur I launched. If anyone needs plumbing services, ABM Plumbing and Heating, they're an indigenous business that's based out of PA that Futurepreneur helped launch, and went for dinner with them. And they were talking about how they're still developing their best target market. They're still working through these various areas. So you're always going to be growing. You're always going to be evolving. And that's what it's about. So back to the validation map. So the validation map for everyone online, I want everyone to, in the top left-hand corner, you're going to see that there's the product and service section. That's where we're going to be focusing on first. There's the target client on the top right-hand side. There's the credibility or background section on the lower right-hand side. And then your value proposition on the lower left-hand side. So we're looking at product and service, target client, credibility, and value proposition. These are the four quadrants. And what we're going to do first is there's a series of steps we're going to take. We're going to write down the details that we know today. We're going to figure out, and we're going to use dashes for that. So if you're able to put down some information that you know, we're going to put a dash, put that information down. We're going to figure out what are the gaps that you're missing. We're going to circle those gaps after we figure those out. And then once we've identified those gaps, we're going to create an action plan and actually start addressing those gaps as we go through. So without further ado, we're going to start on the product and service. So the product and service is the first pillar of your business plan, because if you don't have a product and service, you don't have a business, right? Like, you need to be able to outline what your product and service is. What problem are you solving? What job are you completing for a client, right? And that starts with your product and service and being able to succinctly articulate it in a way that can be communicated not only to your clients, but so that your clients can communicate that to other potential or better fit customers or clients of yours. So that's the first pillar of the business plan. If you haven't totally figured out your product and service yet, start to make a prototype, start to figure out, you know, what you're going to be selling. If you're thinking about doing a workshop, create the curriculum for the workshop. You know, starting to work on your product and service is the best place to start. Okay. So the two key areas we're going to focus on first in terms of alignment is your credibility as it relates to your product and service, right? So our friend here, he was a Red Seal journeyman in welding. You know, without that accreditation or without that skill and background, could I open a welding business? Probably not, because I need to have the background, experience, and credibility in order to have the know-how to create a welding business, right? So what we're going to start is we're going to start in the credibility section. So if you're online, it's going to be the bottom right-hand corner. And it's about building up, like, why you're the best to deliver this product and service, right? So we're going to start in the credibility section and relate that to your product and service. Okay. So to start, so, you know, credibility, it doesn't necessarily have to be related to, you know, to schooling and everything like that. It's really, in terms of one of the tips I like to say is embrace the role of the storyteller. You know, as indigenous peoples, we are inherently some of the best storytellers on earth. You know, it's a strong way that we've been able to transfer knowledge for, you know, millennia, and embrace that, right? So focus on your passions, strengths, and experience for the company you're starting. So don't necessarily just kind of outline and regurgitate your resume. Regurgitate the information that really is going to relate to the success of you delivering on your product and service. Okay, so while you're telling your story, ask yourself, so what? Like, is this information going to be relevant to the customer me delivering on my product and service? So if I took a food handler's safety certification 5 years ago, but I'm doing a welding business, is that really going to be relevant to that business? You know, probably not, because hopefully you're not, you know, welding while you're doing a catering service on the side there, right? So while we get started, oh yeah, by the way, Thanks, thanks for the food and Steve providing that. You know, I like to tell a little bit of a joke when I can, but we had some mashed potatoes today. But nothing beats Rez mashed potatoes. Who knows why? Because you cook them and you mush them. Yeah, absolutely. Okay, so nothing beats Rez mashed potatoes. You know, you got to start off with a little icebreaker there. But the purpose is to make sure that the details you're including directly are directly relevant to your business and how it's going to be successful. Okay, so what I want everyone to do, and maybe if you want to start working in groups, is and for the next two to like while I'm talking as well, start to write down the aspects of yourself that are really going to support your business model. So if it's relevant work experience, if it's life experience, if it's, you know, traditional knowledge that's been gifted to you, you know, that's important. You know, as Indigenous peoples, we don't need to get, affirmations from Western, you know, colonial education systems. The knowledge that's transferred through us, through our communities and through our families, is just as valuable as those education systems. So make sure that you highlight those if it's relevant to your business, like yours, my friend there with the Queen therapy business, right? Put down achievements or awards that might be relevant to your business, right? If you've been recognized for your services and the products that you've been providing, or your relevant work experience, do that. If you're, talk about your standing in the community or networks. You know, if you have an excellent connection in the community, or if you're, you know, a pillar of your community, or like an influential member of your community, make sure you're putting down those networks. So what I like to see is everyone starting to write down a little bit on their validation map on some of these aspects. So perceived gifts, right? Maybe you have a gift you have the ability to connect with anyone that you talk to. You know, everyone has their own gifts, right? Some people are highly technical and are able to get down into the operations of the business. Others have gifts in terms of being able to connect with clients or building those relationships, right? So try to create a compelling story. And we've heard some compelling stories today. I think when Vice Chief walked in, he told a really compelling story about his journey, right? So try to create that story. And this is the first point where you're going to be starting to sell have clients buy into your business. We're talking about authentic pitches. And what I loved about what Vice Chief was mentioning is that if you're nervous, if you're doing a pitch and you're nervous, that just shows that you care, right? So it creates that authenticity. It shows that you care about your product, and that's what it's all about. So I want everyone, if you have industry contacts, customer contacts, right? If you've been working in an industry for, you know, 15 years and you know everyone and anyone in that industry, well, that's a huge asset, right? That's a huge way that you can, you know, have a tribe of mentors that are going to support you in terms of getting off the ground. So everyone, so when you're putting in detailed information that you know, then you're going to put a dash and you're going to start writing that in there. So take a moment, start putting in some of your background and experience that's going to be with keeping in mind of how that's going to be relating to your product and service. Okay. So, so if it's your team, so we'll mention this, it's really about, and not only yourself, but your team. I should note that too. So if you have a team with over 100 years of relevant work experience, that adds to your credibility of your business, right? If your family have been traditional knowledge keepers, you know, for millennia, then put that in your credibility, because you're a respected member of the community, and your family has that knowledge and is a trusted source of that knowledge, right? So start to write that down, ideate. But does anyone have any questions in regards to credibility, in terms of why it's important? It's particularly with lending, it's important because we want to see that you have the know-how and expertise to deliver on your product and service. Okay. One of the first sections that, you know, if you talk to angel investors or you talk to really any lender, they'll look at the management section of your company profile section. Who's behind the business, right? Who's going to be executing on the deliverables of the business. So it's important that you really take some time to think about that. Who's your team? Who's going to be supporting you? So take maybe 2 minutes, write down some information. I'll walk around, see if anyone has any questions, And then, and so write that on your credibility section of your validation map. Take 2 minutes to do that.
All right, there you guys go. If you want to participate online, you can do so. We're here, part two of the afternoon session for the partnership that was created by Future Paneer and Seif. If you guys are just tuning in and you want to know what's going on, those two organizations are showing how you can become an indigenous entrepreneur with their help as well, through grants and loans and, you know, even if you only got $20 in your bank, and how they can help and get you to that next level you've been wanting to get with marketing and, you know, helping with finances as well. So we are live here in PA, at the PA Inn in Prince Albert here. So, and who you were talking to that, or you were talking to that is... There. And I do apologize, you guys, if the audio starts sounding funny, let me know in the comments right away, because it's these new headsets I got that are changing or disconnecting my mixer. So anyway, we're live here in the PAN, and you guys are more than welcome to participate online. And there was packages that were going to be sent to you guys if you did request them. And if you are following along, please continue to do so. And if you're in Saskatchewan right now, drink a lot of water. I think right now I'm looking on my phone and it's like plus 35 right now. So be safe out there. It's hot. We're not used to this kind of heat, but it seems like every other year it's starting to get hotter and hotter. So today is just one of those days. End of August, September 1st, tomorrow, the beginning of, fall is coming. Orange colors, so it's actually good to start as well. If you're looking to change something and do something new, now's the perfect time. It never is the perfect time, but every day is the perfect time if you want to change. So there's my little quote unquote. Every day is a perfect day to do something different or do something you love. But you got a credibility up there that Futurepreneur Noah Wilson is showing in the. If you guys do have any questions, I'm going to put his email here. You guys can email him, nwilson@futurepreneur.ca. His name is Noah Wilson. He's based in Winnipeg. And I think they're going to start doing more of these things live, which is good. So you can participate in the comfort of your home or wherever you are, at work or wherever. I had a few people messaging me that were at work trying to watch these things. So that's good to know. You know, everyone, I think, honestly, has a entrepreneur inside of them, you know, that wants to come out. And, you know, we all have these crazy ideas to make money sometimes. And, you know, it gets exciting. But when you do get involved to being an entrepreneur, it's a lot of work. It requires your full attention. And there's a lot of details. But overall, it's so worth it, because you know, you get to do what you love and just do all these cool things, and you learn and you meet a lot of new people. And
all right. Yeah. So it's really important that we write down anything.
A story of resiliency, right? That is a part of it. Of
what is going to be wanting, like why individuals... they might see themselves in you and want to support that, because they would want someone to support them when they take that journey, right? So your story is just as important as your background and experience or work experience. You know, it's important to tell your story, right? So I want to see that, you know, by the end of it, everyone has something written down, okay? So I'm going to trust that everyone does. So credibility is a great starting point, because we know who we are, right? It's not easy. It might not be easy for us to talk about ourselves with others, but we know our story. We know who we are as people. We know our family. We know our background and experience, right? So start there. Let's start there. And everyone online, hopefully you're following along and jotting down some information there too. So why is this relevant? Well, like I mentioned, we're going to be moving to your product and service, right? So how does your credibility and background relate to your product and service? So we mentioned earlier today, gentlemen here, do you want to share like how long you've been working with horses for? 20 plus years, right? So when we're talking about an equine therapy business, we know that there's someone behind the business that has 20 plus years of experience dealing with horses. So that gives me the confidence as let's say I'm a school board member and you're pitching to me your business that's have some kind of youth come in and be supported by your business. The fact that you've been working with horses for 20 years, you know them in and out, you know how to handle them properly, you're able to articulate that and teach that to youth, that's important in terms of you being able to deliver your product and service. But the important thing about your product and service is being able to articulate it in a simple and effective manner, right? So I mentioned earlier, so I have a couple examples out here. So so we're talking about clothing. I have a clothing business. Great. What kind of clothing? Like, I mean, you know, what do you mean by that? Well, actually I have an online, so you're telling us where location is, could be a storefront. I have an online women's athletic wear clothing store. And I'm going to take it one step further. It's going to be focusing on yoga because that's the target market I want to focus on, right? So once you're starting to break down that even more, so what's important about that is it's an online women's athletic wear clothing store. And what you can start doing is starting to write characteristics about your product above once you have that basic sentence built down, right? So for example, you know, let's just use this example for the yoga, right? So the characteristics around the athletic wear clothing store, right? And that's focusing on women's athletic wear clothing store and yoga. What's the characteristics about it? So what you're going to do in your product and service section is you're going to start off with a simple sentence about your business, but try to be detailed, break it down a little bit more, like I mentioned earlier, and then start to write characteristics around it. You know, what is the materials you use for the athletic wear clothing store? Maybe you're trying to message around fight against fast fashion clothing so that you're using sustainable materials that have been recycled. You know, that's an important aspect that your target market might appreciate, right? Is it handmade? You know, if that's an aspect of your product and service. So start to write the characteristics of your product and service so you can start to articulate that to clients, right? Is it one of a kind? Is it custom? Is there a durability aspect to it? Is there only one, you know, one provider in the whole region, right? So once you have that simple sentence, start to write characteristics about everything that you can think about your product and service. You should know it in and out. You know, when I used to work at retail and I used to sell watches at this store called Spare Parts, and it's called product knowledge, right? When you're selling, one of the biggest things in terms of that job was learning about the product knowledge. So knowing how to handle the watch, even presenting it, you know, making sure you show the client the weight of the watch to show the quality, to outline the key little features in there that other people might miss. Is it automatic or is it battery powered, right? So you want to know every aspect of that product and service so you can articulate it and build value in your product and service, right? So if you don't, and the idea here is not to try to build the, you know, you don't necessarily, especially as a new startup, you don't want to sell around price. You want to be able to build the quality up into your business. And that comes from knowing your product inside and out. So that's a product-based business, right? So what if you're telling me, well, I do a service, like how do I articulate that? Well, let's use this example for plumbing. So Wiglaus Plumbings provide expert residential and commercial plumbing services with the focus on the following services. So it told us a lot. It's focuses, you do both residential and commercial. So if you told me you were just, yeah, I do plumbing. Okay. Well, I'm a general contractor. Can you help me out? Oh yeah, I do commercial. Well, let's take that part of the sentence out of there. I do residential and commercial. So if you talk to me, I'm a general contractor. You'd be like, oh, you know what? I'm a general contractor. Like we're building 5 houses. Do you think you can help us with some of the plumbing? Yeah. You know, I've done commercial work before. Or maybe, you know what? No, I don't. Actually, I actually just focus on residential. And that's okay too. You have to know yourself. You have to know your business. You have to know where you want to kind of have your niche within the market, right? And the important part, the second important part is, so once you have that simple sentence, so write a simple sentence of what your business is, start to write down all the characteristics that you can think about that business, like, and just, you know, jot note around. If you're losing space on your validation map, just flip it over and start to write more characteristics on the back. But really, you want to break down, you want to have every aspect of it. Think of being, you know, I like to use that watch analogy, right? Like, there's so many, you know, I could just tell you, here's a watch, I'll tell you time. What? Who's excited about that, right? Obviously, it tells time. Well, this is the watch that you're gonna go out when, and who are you buying this watch for? Oh, I'm buying it for my husband for our anniversary. Oh, wow. How long have you guys been married? 20 years? Wow, well, you gotta get a special piece for that. This watch, you know, feel the weight of it, right? It's automatic, right? So he's never gonna have to change the battery again. You know, look at the weight of the links on this, you know, look at the little accents of the rose gold within the dials in there, right? So you're building up the value of that watch. Yeah, it tells time, but when you're going out for that anniversary dinner, he's gonna be walking with a swagger when he's walking in the room, because he has one of the nicest watches around, right? Because you're building that value into that, right? So start to write the characteristics. What are the materials? Is it fresh? You know, if you're selling food, is it locally sourced? You know, are you getting it from a local farmer's market in PA? Like, there's restaurants that base their whole business model around their ingredients. So are you able to articulate that? That's very important. But then what you want to do is start to understand where your revenue streams are coming from. And this is one of the harder parts, but this is also important, because if you start working with Futurepreneur or you start working with a Saskatchewan Startup Institute, you want to be able to start thinking about how you're packaging up how you're going to be making sales, right? So if I'm selling an online women's athletic wear clothing store, I got to change that sentence around. I don't think it flows very nicely, but innovation, right? Iteration. That's what entrepreneurship's all about, being critical, self-critical. But what I know is I'm going to be selling yoga pants. I'm going to have two colors. And based on my market research, and this is, we're going to talk about this later, I know that yoga pants sell around $80 these days, and I'm going to have two colors. So I know that's one potential revenue stream that I'm going to be getting from. I know that I'm going to sell sweatshirts that have a cool logo from a local indigenous artist that's going to be on there. That's going to incorporate, you know, indigenous traditional values within the aspect of our yoga business. And I'm also going to sell yoga accessories, right? So if, let's say that you're a dollar store or something like that, and you have like a million different products there. Well, what you want to start doing is thinking about packaging up those into like their basic price ranges, right? So you can have, you know, big ticket items, you know, the medium size costs. So, and this is one of the harder parts of that, but think about, you know, if you have, if you have a lash business, and what are you going to be selling that as that? Because when we start doing our cash flows and things like that, this is going to come very, it's going to be important in there. Right now, is it absolutely essential that you know this? No, but you want to start thinking about what are the categories, what are you exactly selling in terms of that. So with the plumbing business, I want to know what kind of services you provide. Yeah, you do plumbing, but I mean, there's lots of, I mean, do you do HVAC too? Like a lot of plumbers and also have some HVAC backgrounds around. Well, this business, we focus mainly on plumbing installation repair, water heater replacements, boiler installments and repair. And in terms of costs, it's around $32 an hour, or if it's a large project, I'll have to do an estimation, right? And then if you have to do estimations, you can start to break down, well, what's a large project? Well, a large project is, you know, something that takes, you know, a week of my time. It's going to cost me this in terms of being able to do it. So you can start to break down what's a large project, what's a small project, and what's a medium-sized project. So it's a way of thinking about how much time and energy is going to be going into like these service-based businesses, or you can just kind of simplify it and try to, you know, put it into some kind of hourly rate. You know, it's hard to be, you know, super broad about things, but this is just an example of how to do that. So does anyone have any questions around the product or service? This is not an easy section, right? Like, although we're trying to create a clear, specific statement about your business, this is, it's not easy. It's not easy to break it down like that. Does anyone have a question around that? I'll do one whole minute of awkward silence to give people the motivation to speak up if they have a question. It's powerful. Awkward silence is very powerful. No questions? Everyone has it all together? I love it. I love it. Yeah. So if you say, yeah, exactly. And the best way to start doing that is through market research. So we'll start. And so shout out to Saskatchewan Startup Institute. If you don't know what your price and pricing, let me tell you this. One of the hardest parts of your business plan will be pricing. And what I'll say more times than not, especially our Indigenous entrepreneurs, they tend to undervalue their products and services. They tend to underprice. It is always easier to go down in price than it is to go up in price after you start to have a customer base. So look at the market. Start with Saskatchewan Startup Institute. Look at your competitors, right? Even if your competitors are in Saskatoon, but you're going to be based out of here, look at what they're selling their products and service for so that you can position yourself in the market, right? So, if you look at plumbing services, well, you know, if you've had, let's say you've been working in the industry for 10 years and you want to open your own business, well, you're going to know what the hourly rate is. You know what the hourly rate to the client is generally, right? And you should also have an idea of what your personal hourly rate is. You always want to build in margins in terms of costs to the consumer, right? You always want to mark up on that. But I don't want to get into too much lingo right now, but really the best way to start in terms of figuring out your product and service is through market research, looking at competitors. That's the easiest way. You know, lots of businesses have whole departments, like let's say large corporations, they have whole departments that just look at competitor analysis. All they do all day is look at what the competitors are doing. What are they pricing? What's their next project they're going on? Because they want to be able to stay on top of that. They want to make sure that they're not going to fall behind the curve in terms of like what new products and services are coming out and that they're not going to lose market share in terms of their established market, right? So it's very, very important to be, you know, they have secret shoppers that'll go into other banks and ask questions, things like that. Like there's so many examples of why competitors and being on the pulse of what your competition is doing is very important, right? So that's how you can start to figure out your pricing. One of the easier ways of doing that. But for example, like what I really want you to do is break down what is your product and service to minute details, right? So you have a health and wellness spa, right? Well, how much does that tell me about your business if you were just to tell me that, right? Well, I have a health and wellness spa that does nails, that does hair, that does foot massages. And not only that, we have counseling services on the side, right? So you're starting to break down what your health and wellness service is all about, right? You sell women's athletic clothing wear. Well, I'm about to go golfing. Do you sell women's golf shirts? No, I actually just focus on yoga, right? That's not your customer. That's not your best customer. You have to know what space you're in. So that's very important. Thanks for asking that question. Does anyone have any other questions? If you have a question, there's a 99% chance someone else is thinking about that. Like I would say, right? It's all relevant. So that's part of, remember when we were doing our pitches, this is all about articulating the product and service, right? So the more that we do these, the more that we're going to be able to figure it out. So moving on. This is what your validation map should start looking like, right? So let's use another example here. So, you know, I've had my education degree. I've worked 2 years in public school system. I've seen the gaps in the public school system. I know that our youth are behind in terms of their math development. I'm also a well-known teacher in the community. I'm always volunteering. I'm a part of X, Y, and Z boards. And you know what? I've done curriculum development for a private school. So I have a little bit of experience, I would say more than a little bit of experience doing curriculum development. I feel like I have the ability to be an entrepreneur and I can be successful. One of the biggest problems I've seen, because business at the end of the day is about problem solving in a lot of senses, or you're solving a job for someone, you're completing a job for someone. One of the things I saw in the public school system is that, and statistically speaking, you know, this region of Saskatchewan is underperforming in math, in terms of the math things. So I know that there's a gap, there's a problem, right? So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna start teaching math basics course. It's gonna be a 3-hour online and in-person workshop. So you're telling us location, is it online, is it in-person, is it brick and mortar, right? And then I'm gonna tell you the breakdown of my services. So I'm gonna break down you have a workshop, okay. Well, are you gonna have 100 kids in the class? No, well, I'm only going to have 12 because I know any more than 12 is just going to be chaos. I'm not going to be able to be engaging. How many workshops are you going to have, or how many classes? Well, I'm going to have 10 classes a week. I think based on my, you know, time management, I've worked out a schedule. I could fit in 10 classes comfortably. And those are going to be online. Well, you said you're online and in person. Well, how are you going to do? Well, I'm going to do 8 classes in person because, you know, the coordination. I'm going to have to get a space. So I can only do 8 a week, I'm thinking, right? And they're going to start testing this out, right? That's important too. Start testing your business, start testing your prototypes, start putting it out there and seeing what the response is. And when am I going to do it? Well, I'm going to do it evenings and weekends because that's the time I have, right? And then you know what? I'm going to do 1 hour private tutoring in home for $40 an hour. And that's my proxy. So you can see how I had a simple idea of math basics, but you can even go deeper, right? The details about the math basics. So maybe you've created an innovative way of teaching youth about math, right? Maybe you've made a fun and engaging way of teaching youth. Well, start to explain it. Start putting those details down, right? That's what's going to ultimately set you apart in terms of being a math tutor. So based on your credibility, background, and experience, you've identified a problem. Clearly, the province has identified the problem. The community has identified the problem. And maybe the youth have identified that I can't go through this math course without falling asleep. Great. Well, I have a math course for you that's going to help you increase your math grades. It's going to be highly engaging because we're going to get you active. You know, I have an active land-based teaching course that's going to teach you about math. And we're going to do it on XYZ, right? So you're starting to build out the qualities of your business. So your page should be filled out, like I'm telling you. And if you need to flip it over, that's great, right? So that's what it should start looking like. And you might be asking, like, great, I'm doing all this, I'm writing it down. Like, how does this relate to my business plan? Well, all of this information is going to be relevant to one of the two key sections of your business. We're starting out your business, and I'll show you right now. So your company profile. So we're talking about your credibility and background. Well, in one of the first sections of your business plan is going to be your company profile. I mean, there's other verbiage around it, but it's really who's the face of your business, the profile, the face of your company, right? So management, that's where your credibility comes in. All the information that you've put in there on the credibility section, that's where you're going to be putting it in the management section. Who's going to be running the business, right? Do you have someone who's an expert on operations? Great. Well, you need someone who's, you know, strong in business development, right? So those are your two team members that are going to be driving the business. So the credibility section is going to be highly relevant in the management section. Right? That storytelling I told everyone about in the credibility section, that's going to be part of your company history. You know, where did you start? Right? Company history. I've been working in education system. I've noticed that math scores have been declining over the years, and I knew that there was a problem that needed to be solved. Right? So I started doing a workshop every weekend, and it's actually turned, you know, I'm getting so much requests, I don't have enough time for it, but I really see a market opportunity for that. So you start to put in how much sales you've had, how many networks. So that all goes into your company history section. That's that storytelling, right? All of this information that you're writing down right now, what you're putting down is going to be relevant when you start writing your business. And really what's important in terms of that also as well is your business overview and your product and service listing. So it's telling us, you know, What does your company do? Who's involved? How did it start? And how are you breaking down in terms of like what your expected revenues might be in terms of your lines of revenue? Like what products and services are you delivering in terms of your selling? So all of this information in terms of your product and service, you're gonna find a place and way to articulate that and start putting this into paragraphs in your business plan. So everything we're doing today is relevant to your business plan because it's going to help you build out your company profile section of your business plan. And then, so you notice that there's value proposition in there. So there's all these different templates, but all this information will fit within the template you're working on. Legal structure, you know, go to Saskatchewan Startup Institute. They have a really great Ask an Expert program, by the way. You can speak with a lawyer or an accountant for $25, which is amazing. I've worked with accountants and lawyers, and let me tell you, yeah, they're not cheap. So that's a good offering. So that's how it's relevant to your business plan. So this ties back to your business plan. All right. So so now we're going to be focusing on what's holding you back. So we wrote a bunch of details, right? We wrote a bunch of details into our business, but there's all of these areas that I don't know about, right? So we talked about licensing, permits, things like that. Start to look at what's holding you back and start to create gaps, right? So let's go through that. And this is relevant to your operations section of your business plan. We'll go into that in a second here. So depending on the timing, this 152. 2:30. Okay, we're good. So I want everyone to start filling the gaps. So identify the missing pieces of your product and service and your and potentially your credibility and background, right? If you want to create a counseling service, well, you're probably going to have to be registered with some kind of regulatory body. So maybe you need to do X, Y, and Z to start becoming a part of that regulatory body or oversight, you know, organization, professional association, I should say, right? So start identifying the missing gap. So for your product and service, right? Have you made a prototype, right? If you want to create a restaurant, well, do you have a menu yet? Have you identified your ingredients, right? You know, how are you going to be teaching staff later on the line in terms of making your products and service if you have a food business, right? If you're creating like, let's say a tutoring business, have you created a curriculum yet? If no, well, that's a gap. So what I want you all to start doing is if you have a product and service, let's say I want to create a math tutoring business and I'm great. I know that there's an opportunity here. I haven't created a curriculum yet. Well, I'm going to put gap curriculum and then I'm going to circle it because I know that's a gap. And that's how we're going to look back at this and we're going to know exactly what's a gap and what's a detail I know, right? If you haven't made a prototype, but you have a great idea, right? Then your gap is create a prototype, create my first offering. And then, put it out there, right? Have you delivered your product or service before? So start looking into that, right? Find the gaps.
That's the first pillar of your business.
Location. So in part of the description of those product and service descriptions, you know, we said online, or we said we have a storefront, right? So is it e-commerce? You know, are you mainly just going to be selling on Facebook Marketplace? In terms of your history, do you need a food truck? You know, if you're making a restaurant business, are you going to start with a food cart? Are you going to start with a food truck? Are you looking to get in brick and mortar right away? Tell us more about that. Are you going to have an office space? Maybe you can work out of your home. Okay. Is it a pop-up shop, Palo Trail table, right? Where are you going to be selling your product and service? If you don't know where, location, I don't know where. That's a gap. Okay. Circle that. Okay. Processes and production costs. All right. So how will they pay, right? Are they just going to send you an e-transfer? You know, how are they going to pay you? Do you need a point of sale system, like a debit machine? So you make the inventory, are you going to have a Shopify, right? To start making sales. So how will they pay? Inventory, right? How much does your inventory cost? Do you have suppliers for that? And what is the cost of making, of delivering my product and service? And one of the biggest things I see with entrepreneurs is that they don't put in the value or time, the value of the amount of time that they put in into making their product and service. So imagine that if you had to pay someone else to deliver your product and service or make your product and service, what would you pay them an hour? And if it takes you 2 hours to deliver that product and service, well, that's a cost related to you delivering that product and service. You should be starting to think about that. What type of equipment do you need to start doing your business, right? If you're not sure what type of equipment you need, well, that's a gap you need to start figuring out. You know, how long does it take to deliver? Do you need software? So all of these areas, like, don't get overwhelmed. What we're going to do is we're going to pick 1 to 2 of these gaps and we're going to start actioning them this week. And then the next week, we're going to do this exercise again. We're going to find another gap. We're going to action those gaps, right? It's about finding gaps in our thing and starting to work towards them. You know, I haven't done a market research request yet to find competitors. My goal will be to work with Saskatchewan Startup Institute, right? Right. Suppliers, right? If you're a restaurant, where are you going to be getting your inventory, right? That could be a make or break for restaurants or anything. Like I was talking with a plumbing, I went for lunch with the plumbing business, right? And they were talking about the supply chain for plumbing, right? They have customers, they have service, but if you don't have a good supplier set up, that could be a make or break for your business. So if you don't have a supplier, that's a gap. Equipment and contracting. Is there going to be aspects of your business that you're going to need to subcontract to someone else? Right. I was working with a driveway paving business and he had all the materials to do the paving, but he didn't have a skid steer at the time to remove all of the gravel and stuff out of there. So he had to subcontract that out. Maybe that's an opportunity for a capital cost that might create some efficiencies and allow you to save a little bit on that. So creating those gaps, right?
Not creating, finding out. In
insurance, regulatory, and legal issues, right? Going to Saskatchewan Startup Institute, starting to work on what kind of permits, license, and zoning things do you need in terms of your municipality? You know, do you need worker health and safety if you're going to have employees? Food handling, that's huge for home-based businesses that start out with really great products. You know, make sure that you're starting to look at a commercial kitchen. You know, these things are super important. GST and PST number, your payroll number. You know, if you have a payroll, if you have to have staff and payroll, well, you're going to have to get a payroll number to do remittance for Canadian Pension Plan and EI. So, you know, these are the things you're going to have to start saying. These are gaps, right? So if you don't know what your permits or issues you need, that's a gap. Circle it. Human resources. So this is one of the biggest things I want to talk about too. Who will run operations and who will be running business development and marketing to drive sales? There's a lot of times where business owners, they know how to deliver their product and service. They've done it. You know, I've been a Red Seal journeyman for 20 years. I know what I'm doing. I know how to deliver it. Okay. Well, what happens if you're done this project and you didn't do any business development in between then, and now you're sitting for 2 weeks trying to find another job, right? So you need someone, or you need to start planning it within your schedule to get that next job, right? If you're so focused on delivering on your current project, then you might forget that you need to line up the next project, right? So if you need to hire someone or get another partner who's focusing on business development, you can't just focus on delivering the product and service. You need to focus on, you know, how are you driving sales into the future? So if you need to have, if you need to make sure that you're putting in time and scheduling in time to do, you know, bid calls and calling general contractors and doing that business development, then you need to be doing that, right? Because it's not just about delivering your product and service. It's about building out those next opportunities to sell. And why is this important? Well, it's directly related to your operations section of your business plan. Where are you located? What insurance and regulatory issues are you going to have to overcome, right? Human resources and contractors, who's focusing on, who's your chef for your restaurant, right? Who's running the front end in terms of the services for the customer? Like, are you going to expect your chef to run out in the front, serve the clients, run back, you know, do the prep and pickup, and then hostess, like, you know, like, you got to think about those human resources. You know, human resources, I always say, are the most valuable resource of any business. You want to be able to take care of them. Do you need to get them benefits? Is that something that's important to you? Like, all of these things, right? And I would say the most important probably section of the business plan that I look at probably first is the process and production costs, but more or less, like, how are you delivering your product and service? What is the client journey, right? You call 10 contractors, you get one bid, you accept the bid, you give an estimation of the costs, and then you have the client follow up, right? What is your process of making a sale? How long does it take you to ship, right? How are you delivering your product and service? You can have a great product or service, but if you don't have the operations in play to deliver that product and service, then you're going to be in trouble. And that's a great way, that's a fast way to create negative client experiences. So you want to have good operations built out, and you want to also know who your suppliers are. So all of these gaps we're looking for are going to help you fill out your operations section down the line. Okay, so this is what it should look like. Okay, so credibility. Maybe I needed to be accredited. This is kind of just examples. Like, right? Maybe I need to be accredited, service provider in terms of, you know, being able to do this tutoring service for private schools or something like that, right? That's a gap that I figured out. In terms of the product and service section, you know, I don't know what the cost, wages, and materials it is to deliver this on a regular basis. Maybe I can only write a certain amount of curriculum in a myself. It's going to take me 2 years to write out the amount of curriculum I need. Well, maybe I need to find curriculum developers or curriculum writers, right? That's a gap. I mean, I'm talking about doing in-person teaching classes. Well, am I going to bring 12 kids into my house? No, I don't. I like a clean house. So I'm not going to bring in 10 of strangers' kids into my house. I am going to find a venue for classes, right? That's a gap. So that's, I'm going to circle that. I need to find two teachers to hire, because I realized if I'm going to do 12 classes, 12 kids a class, you know, 10 classes online, 8 in person, like, I'm only one person. I'm going to need to hire two people, right? And what's my availability? So everyone should start circling their gaps. And if you only have one or two, or maybe you have 20 or 30, all I want you to focus on is one or two for every week until we knock these down, right? 50 hours we're talking about at times, depending on the business model. I mean, it's important to take these, look into these gaps, because I was talking with Community Futures, and there's been businesses where they've launched and then all of a sudden they're identifying these gaps after they've launched, right? If you're able to start looking at identifying these gaps early, you're able to mitigate risk. You know, risk mitigation is big in business, right? That's a key aspect of the operations section that we look at. So starting to create those gaps, okay? So what we're going to do is we are going to spend 10 minutes. I want everyone working in circles, but I want everyone asking each other to start to figure out some of their gaps, right? Ask each other, like, you know, what is your, like, how do you deliver your product and service? And then you're like, well, you know what? Maybe I need to work on my process and production, right? So let's do 10 minutes max. Of everyone working around the circle, let's do like 2 minutes a person if we can, or pick, or what are we doing? We have, Try to pick a pair, or like, maybe everyone. Okay. So everyone choose one person in the group and then start to kind of shoot out some questions, but don't get too aggressive with gaps or anything like that. Just be like, you know, like try to help them along here in terms of figuring out what gaps they might be missing. Like, hey, do you have a license and permit to do food handling? Are you working at a commercial kitchen? Because I know that, you know, you could get into liability concerns if you're not out of a safe working kitchen, things like that. So take about 5-10 minutes to start asking each other questions about each other's business and start to help them identify their gaps kindly. And help them with that. And then we'll come back. And then what we're going to do is we're going to find those gaps and we're create an action plan around that. Okay. So take 5 to 10. We are going to, we're doing good. So start to ask each other some gaps that we can find in terms of your products and service or credibility. Okay. And just keep in mind, this is all going to help you in the long run. You know, this is really, it's all about, and how many experiences are you able to have with other like-minded individuals to start helping you identify these areas. All right. So I'm going to walk around, make sure that people are getting active, staying involved, and we'll be back soon. And everyone on live, you know, find a friend, call a friend, pitch your idea and say, can you try to find some gaps in that? And if you're open-minded to it, then you're already prepared, right? So call a friend right now, say, hey, I'm in this crazy workshop right now. I'm trying to find some gaps. This is my, you're going to practice your pitch real fast. And you're like, help me find some gaps in my product and service. Okay. So I'll stop talking now. I'm sorry.
All right, there we go. Noah Wilson. Put that on the screen. You guys can take a look at it. I'll put a big screen there. So we're live here at PAN with, you just heard Futurepreneur Noah Wilson speaking. Yes. And then we are going to try and get a few more people on here to come and talk about their businesses. I know I have, you see, old and young here. There's all sorts here that would like to become business owners, which is pretty good. Which is really good. You know, it's nice to see the drive and ambition to do something new and create something for themselves and their own. So if you guys are around in PA, come and stop by at PAN and check us out. Play a little background music here. We'll be back. Thank you.
Thank you.
All right. All righty. You know what I love? I love a room full of conversation. If I heard just dead silence, I would have been a little nervous, but I'm hearing laughter. I'm hearing engagement. So this is beautiful. So I've been walking around. I see people putting the gaps around their service, around the company profile and operation concerns that they're looking for. But what we need to do now is we need to commit to action, right? We need to start working towards knocking down these lists, and you don't have to conquer Rome in a day, right? Like it's a slow process, right? At times, but you want to start knocking them down and starting to break that down. So what I want everyone to do is set some goals based on your validation map. So based on the gaps, if you look at all the circles on your validation map, if you have a circle on your validation map, I want you to create an action item around that. So this is how it's going to look. All right. So if everyone sees here in the credibility section, one of the gaps I've identified is I'm not accredited in the certain accreditation I need. So my action item, what I'm going to put a square around is start accreditation process by January 1st. And you know what makes this a great action item? It's SMART. It's a SMART goal. Who's heard of this acronym before? A SMART goal. Well, anytime you make a goal, you should think about it. I need to make this goal SMART. How do I do that? Well, it should be specific. It needs to be specific. So I'm going to start an accreditation process. So I would even go even more specific. Where? I'm going to create an accreditation process at SAS Polytech Institute. And is it measurable? Yeah. Well, I'll know I got the accreditation when I get the piece of paper in my hand. That's measurable. That's a way of quantifying or qualitatively measuring whether I've done it or not. Is it attainable? Heck yeah. All I got to do is the course. I got to make some time. I might have to get some, it's going to be a struggle, but you know what? It's attainable, right? Is it relevant? Is this going to be relevant to your business and you projecting your goal? Well, yeah, it's highly relevant because it's a gap I've identified in my validation map. And the single most important part of your SMART goal is it time specific. I'm going to do this by January 1st, right? So you put down a date and you hold yourself to that, right? So look at your gap. So if you look here on the product and service side of this, one of the gaps identified is find a venue for classes. So I'm going to look for, so one of my goals is price 3 venues by March 1st. It's specific. I'm pricing 3 venues, right? It's measurable. Well, once I have 3 venues, I know that I've done it. Is it attainable? Yeah. Get on the phone, call 3 venues up, get some prices. I could probably do that in an hour if I really was focused and got off TikTok, if you're anything like me. And is it relevant? Well, yeah, it is relevant because it's one of the gaps that I've identified in my business. And the most important part, I'm going to do it by March 1st. Okay. Availability is one of the other gaps I have in there. Well, I need to find a part-time job with better hours by Jan 1st. Okay. So notice how there's not 300 action items on here. I have 2 in the credibility section. I have 2 in the product and service section. I have dates that I'm going to do them by. And I would say make a plan to do a goal by next week, to end by next week, or at least start by next week. Okay. So what you're going to do is you're going to have the details, which are dashes. Right? Details that you know and details that you can articulate. You're going to have gaps, which you're going to circle. It's going to help you when you look back. Oh, this is a gap. This is a gap. This is a gap. And then when you look at that gap, you're going to say, okay, I'm going to create a SMART goal around this. And then I'm going to square that SMART goal. Right? So if your gap is, what is the licensing I need for this product or service? Well, my goal is I am going to book an appointment with Saskatchewan Startup Institute by September 4th. All right. And I'm going to focus on the business startup assistance there. And maybe I'm even going to add another thing. I'm going to get an ask an expert. I'm going to book an ask an expert meeting with a lawyer. Okay. That's one way you can start making those relevant goals. Actually, you know what? mandatory goal, I would say, for everyone. Book an appointment with Saskatchewan Startup Institute. I think that's one I always recommend, right? They have secondary market research requests, right? They have business startup assistance in terms of getting your tax accounts set up, right? Make that one of your goals, okay? Everyone can use it, whether you're in business or not, trust me. All right, so that's that. We have about till 2:30. Just look at my trusty agenda here. So we'll have 2:30 and then we'll have a break. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna move, and at 2:30, in about 10 minutes, we'll go on break, because this has been a little bit of a longer section here. But we're gonna kind of move. So details. So when we're talking about, and keep in mind that these are not all in silos. Like, all of this information can be relevant in other sections. That's why it can be confusing at times. But, you know, when I mentioned that we need to go to Saskatchewan Startup Institute, and that needs to be one of your SMART goals, right? I'm going to book a Saskatchewan Startup Institute, and I'm going to get support with a secondary market research request by September 4th. It's because of this, the details, market research. So when you're going through your market research, you want to be able to start focusing on your local market first, right? So if you have a health and wellness business in the community, well, who is your most likely customer in that community or in that area? Well, it's going to be the community that you're in. So you're going to want to start researching the local market. What are the demographics? How many people live there? How much are they spending on health and wellness activities or entertainment, things like that, right? Starting to research your competitors. So pricing. One of the best ways to start figuring out your pricing is to look at competitors, right? You always have a competitor. Don't tell me you don't have a competitor, because there's an option. There's always another option, whether it's a direct relevant product or service. There's always another potential option, right? You can go with Travelocity, or you can go with Kayak, right? That's a direct competitor. But you know, if you're doing a counseling business, well, maybe there's no other counselor in the area, but there's a psychologist that's nearby. That's, you know, even though they're not directly, I guess you could say, counseling in terms of that sense, well, they're a psychologist, they could be a potential competitor, like, right? So it might not be a direct alignment, but it's an option that a potential consumer could take either way, right? And then starting to figure out your best customer. Okay, so that all is going to help you with that market research aspect of building out your business plan, which is one of the first areas you got to start. You know, outside of this and the ideations section, you really want to start with market research and really becoming a subject matter expert in your industry and your products and everything like that. Okay.
All right.
So that's where the validation map with target client and value proposition comes in, right? Because a big part of market research is going to be figuring out where your potential customers are, where is your region, like really kind of diving into that local aspect of your market. It's better always to start local if you can, or, you know, you should be, especially as a small business, right? So we're going to be focusing on the target client and how that relates to the value proposition. And the reason why we're focusing on those two areas is because every client has options. Right. Never in history have we had more options at our fingertips for potential products and services. What's going to set you apart in the eyes of that target client in terms of your value proposition? Right. Convenience. It's the closest health wellness resort in the area. Right. That's going to set you apart from them having to drive to Saskatoon for that client. Right. The value proposition. You know, in terms of that target client, I want to work with the most experienced management group around. That could be your separating factor for the diamond cutting business, right? So that's how we're relating it. In the eyes of, put yourselves into the position of the customer at this point, right? And with that, and that's what we're going to be doing when you're doing market research. You're going to be thinking, or like, how am I going to find my customer? Who's my best customer? You know, what is the demographic breakdown? What's their household income? Starting to figure that out, and we'll dive into that in just a second here. Yeah, we have about 5 minutes before we go on break. So and then we'll come back and then we'll do an exercise. So this is good time. So we need to figure out who your best customer is, AKA your target market. If you go to one of us and say, I was like, who are you selling this product and service to? Well, everyone, anyone can buy the service. Well, yeah, anyone can buy the service, right? But who's going to be your best customer? Who's going to be that 20%, you know, who's sort of the 80-20 rule? Kind of like a universal kind of law, I guess you could say. Who's sort of the 20-80 rule or 80-20 rule? So there's some kind of mathematical, statistical kind of methodology that says, you know, 20% of your activities are going to drive 80% of the results that you are looking for, right? It works with your clients. There's a good chance that 20% of your client portfolio is going to be driving 80% of your revenues. So that's your best customer. Who is that 20% of your customers that are going to be driving 80% of my revenues, right? So, you know, I could go to a spa, right? But am I going to be a regular customer there as opposed to my wife or someone like that, right? Probably not, right? So in terms of your sales and marketing activity, this is why it's important, because when you're figuring out your best customer, that's how it's going to directly relate to your sales and marketing activity. If you market to everyone, you will market to no one. Okay. If you market to everyone, you will market to no one. You won't reach anyone. So you want to be able to create your marketing materials around your best customer. Okay. So there's two general schools of thought in terms of figuring out your best customer, and they're not exclusive to one another. And you can sell to both, but you have to think about who is my best customer. Who's going to be that 20% that's going to be driving 80% of my revenue. Right. So when we're talking about B2C, what does that mean? You'll hear that around business lingo. Are you B2B or B2C? It just means business to consumer. Is my best customer from my business directly to the consumer? So if that's the case, if I have an online retailer and I sell on Shopify, and I know that the products that I'm selling are going directly to the consumers who are buying on my website, right? So what I want everyone to start doing is starting to really break down their best customer, okay? You need to have at least 10 traits. I want everyone to write down like 10 traits about my best customer that I can write down, at least right now, right? So when we're talking about our best customer, you want to start thinking about demographics. What's their age? What's their age range? You know, what's their gender? Does that even matter, right? Is it what's their income? What's their disposable income in that regard? You know, does their education level matter at all? I don't know. Maybe it does. What's their ethnicity? Are you focusing your marketing materials around selling to indigenous peoples, or positioning yourselves as an indigenous, you know, focused business? All of these things matter in terms of messaging, in terms of your sales and marketing. Okay. Lifestyles and values. This is very important as well, right? Like, how are you going to align your product and service to your customer? So I mentioned with the yoga business, I said that we're fighting fast fashion and it's going to be sustainably sourced materials for my women's athletic yoga wear, right? Why is that important? Because I'm trying to sell to women who are between the ages of, you know what the best thing you can do, actually? Create an avatar. I'm going to get everyone, we're going to do an exercise after this, and I want you to create an avatar. So this is what I mean by that. So my best customer is Susie Lee. Susie Lee, you know, she's 25. She's in university right now. She just moved to Saskatoon. She was funded by her community to go there. She doesn't have much disposable income, but when she does have disposable income, she likes to spend it on something that's going to help support her athletic journey. And she really got into yoga recently, but she didn't want to go to Lululemon. She wants to support an indigenous owned business, but she also really cares about sustainability. You know, coming from the community, she was always taught, you know, to respect the consumption that you have, honor the materials and products that you're using. So I really would rather just support someone who has a sustainable business. And when does Susie Lee, like, when am I thinking about buying? Well, my behavior to buy is when I'm starting a yoga class. So in terms of maybe where I want to sell to Susie Lee is I'm going to start putting up posters at yoga schools around the local market, right? Because I'm going to be, my behavior, when is my most likely to buy? When does the need arise? Well, maybe I'm walking out of my yoga class and I want to, you know, I want to feel extra confident when I walk back in there and, oh, wait, what's that poster? Oh, cool. There's an indigenous-owned business that's focusing on yoga athletic wear. Cool. So you're trying to get into the, or, you know, where are they likely? How are you going to be in the, how are you going to put yourself into the routines in the day, right? If you're opening up a coffee shop, right? When is the most likely need to buy? Like, buy, well, on my way to work in the morning and, you know, 10,000 people drive this one road in the morning to Saskatoon and there's an opportunity for a location there. So maybe that's a great activity in terms of the behavior to buy, because when I'm driving to work, I'm going to be driving by, oh, there's a new coffee shop. I'm going to check that out. Boom. That's a behavior. You're trying to get into the behaviors of your clients, right? Location, where's the local, what is the local market, right? So in terms of marketing your materials, you want to think, where's Susie Lee going to be? Well, I may be focusing, since my demographic, Susie Lee, she's 25, she's going to university, she cares about sustainability, I'm going to start focusing on yoga stores that are near university centers. Maybe that's my first location, right? So that's what I mean about creating a story. Give your target client a name, right? Give them an identity, create a story around them. Susie Lee might just be one of them, right? You might have, you know, two or three best clients, but they should be all kind of generally the same in terms of that. I have another example. So moss bags and cradle boards, right? Tiganoggin boards, right? So who's going to be most likely to buy a moss bag or a cradle board? Well, I'm going to say to myself, well, it's probably going to be an indigenous person who's trying to reclaim their language, their culture, and they want to bring their little one into the world wrapped in the arms of their culture, right? Well, who's most likely to buy a moss bag and cradle board? Well, of course, expecting mothers, right? Expecting mothers, or maybe they're family members who are looking for an expecting mother, right? In my area, in my community, most of the expecting mothers are around like 28 to 30, probably. Like, I'm just throwing out numbers here. So just start to think about what is the age range of expecting mothers, and what is their household disposable income? Starting to think about all of that, right? What's their lifestyle and values? Well, who's going to be buying a moss bag and cradle board? Someone who's trying to reclaim their traditional roots, their indigenous traditional roots. That's a value that's important to them, right? Maybe they're going out, they love outdoors and travels, right? Maybe they're living in an area where they need to have a way to carry their little one around, and they would rather do it in a traditional, innovative kind of standpoint in terms of that. Maybe they're really focused on reclaiming their culture, and maybe they want to support local and indigenous. Maybe that's part of their value system. So in terms of your messaging, in terms of your sales and marketing activities, in terms of how you're positioning you're selling your Tiganoggin boards, you're going to be focusing on what kind of speaks to their values and what's their behavior. When are they most likely to be purchasing a moss bag? Well, in terms of behavior wise, it's going to be the expecting mother that's going to be purchasing for a newborn between, you know, a newborn 1 to 2 years old. They may start looking during pregnancy. It might be shortly after pregnancy. And maybe I know that in terms of the behaviors, I mean, if you look at our indigenous communities, we're pretty active on Facebook, right? So maybe I'm going to start looking at mother support groups on Facebook, indigenous mother support groups on Facebook, in terms of trying to get into the behaviors of that individual so I can reach out. And where's my scope? Well, I'm going to focus in more on in terms of my scope. I know that my deliveries, like, I'm going to focus on Cowessess First Nation and the surrounding Regina area. All right. And this is how detailed you should be with your best customer, because this is how you're going to be messaging. This is where you're going to know how to market and start working that. Does anyone have any questions related to the business to consumer? I would expect there should be a question. Silence is powerful. No, everyone has it. All right, I guess we got it all together. Awkward silence. All right. Yes. It does make sense. So when you mentioned to me that most of your, so you're saying that most of your marketing materials, for anyone online, I'm just going to repeat the question. So it says, and correct me if I'm wrong, most of your marketing activities right now are happening on social media, right? Okay. So that's great. Now you know that what your main sales and marketing. So what this is going to help you to do is, what is the most likely social media platform for my best customer? Right. So if I know that Indigenous mothers, between the ages of 28 and 38, they're most likely to be on Facebook. So in terms of my ad dollars that I want to spend, maybe I'm going to focus more on Facebook, right? So it's more about getting into the mind of your customer. Where is my customer? What social media platform? So if I'm focusing on, you know, teenagers between, you know, 14 and 21, then maybe your best platform is TikTok, right? Getting into the mindset of your customer is super important, right? What I will say though is, when you're starting a business, I would say there's like three, like in terms, and we're, you know, this is kind of in the business planning side of things, but when you're starting to create your marketing activities, some of the, like one of, there's three main, I guess, overarching activities you can do, and maybe I can be corrected on this, but there's relationship-based marketing strategies where you're actually focusing on building those relationships in the community. So direct selling, right? Like calling contractors, calling people, going to those, you know, powwows and connecting with people individually, going to businesses, talk, those relationship-based strategies. There's print strategies, right? And radio, like more traditional marketing strategies. So radio, you know, print, the billboard signs, and then there's digital. The most effective sales strategies that you can, you know, do when you're starting off is those relationship-based strategies. Okay, so you really want to be focusing on, how can I start building relationships with my clients, especially locally? Those are, I would say that should be one of your main primary activities, but social media is obviously a huge aspect of business these days. But when you're thinking about, okay, well, what are the relationship-based strategies I can approach for expecting mothers, right? Well, maybe there's a class on, maybe there's a doula class in the community. You go up to that doula instructor, you say, hey, I'm starting a business on Tikkanagan boards. Do you mind if I come in at the 5 minutes at the end, talk to the mothers, tell them about my Tikkanagan boards? Boom, you have, just based on you understanding who your best customer is, you figured out that they're gonna be, the highest likelihood of meeting 10 expecting mothers in one spot is through a doula. So I'm gonna reach out to a doula and I'm gonna ask her if I can pitch my business, see if I can do it. And that relationship-based strategy. So here's another good example of relationship-based strategy. Are you more likely to go to a restaurant because you saw, are you more likely to go to a restaurant because you saw a billboard about it? Or are you more likely to go if your friend tells you you should go, right? You're more likely to go to a restaurant if your friend tells you, or if you hear word around town, you got to go to this restaurant. They have the best, you know, they have the best bannock in all of Prince Albert, right? You know why? Is because there's that inherent trust through relationship. If you can build that consumer trust through those relationship-based strategies, way more likely to make a sale. It's about building trust. Like when you look at a billboard, you inherently know that somebody's selling something. But if you're building that relationship, it's coming from a different place. You're able to build trust a little bit faster. But it's about going to that trusted source. So if all of these mothers trust this doula, they all put their trust in this doula. Why are they in the doula's class? Well, they're trying to prepare themselves for motherhood. They trust this doula. So if this doula brings you in as a new business owner and you're selling Tikkanagan boards, they have an inherent trust in that doula. So they're way more willing to potentially invest into your business because they respect and trust that doula, right? As opposed to you just selling on social media, hi, I have Tikkanagan boards, they cost X amount of dollars. Come get some if you want one, right? If your doula came in, you know, I have an amazing friend. She makes the most gorgeous Tikkanagan boards and cradle moss bags and cradle boards in the world that I've ever seen. And you're going to get hyped up, right? It's about building that trust, building those relationship-based strategies, okay? So that's why you have to get in the mindset of your client, of your best customer. So one thing that I think is overlooked too is business to business. Okay, you know what? We're going to take, before we go, you know what? We'll finish off this quickly. I want to get into this a little bit more. So we're going to take a bit of a break. Let's do Let's do a 15-minute break. Yeah. Let's do a 15-minute. What are we thinking? How is everyone feeling? Do they need a 10 or 15-minute break? Put your hands up for 10. Put your hands up for 15. If we do 15, we'll end sooner. Or 10, we'll do end sooner. No. Are people motivated? Do they want to keep going a bit? We're gonna be ending. So the workshop ends at 3:30. So we have some time. I want to make sure that we kind of, this is a lot, right? Should I make an executive decision here? Let's take 15. Let's take 15. We'll get back. We'll take 15. And if we're running a little bit behind, I'll call everyone back, but stay a little bit close. Just, you know, do your thing for a little bit. Go to the, if you haven't done the draw yet at Community Futures, make sure you do that. Connect with all, this is your last chance to connect does anyone have any draws? Okay. Make sure you go to Cooperatives first. There's a draw there. Take the next 15 minutes to connect with all of our amazing partners. Make sure you enter the draws. Sign up with Saskatchewan Startup Institute. Talk to me over there. Do what you gotta do. Sorry? Oh, yeah. Okay. Nathan's offering this. If you want to pitch your idea to the masses, have an opportunity to test out your pitching skills with Nathan. Opportunities here. So if it's 2:15, we'll be back 5 minutes before 3. We'll do that. Yeah, we're almost done.
You're all scared? Anybody except Tyson? All right, you guys, we're going to see if we can get someone on here. One of the attendees here who are interested. Oh, it looks like we have a young man coming up here from, we'll find out where he's from. We'll find out his business idea. We'll find all of that good stuff. So,
for everyone, make sure you go to Cooperatives first. Sign up for the.
Put that out there, buddy. What's your name?
Aaron.
Aaron. Matto. All right. We got Aaron here. I'm just going to go up here. If you guys have any questions about him, just about him, his ideas, everything, let me know. So, first of all, tell me who you are, where you're from, all that.
My name is Aaron Bella. I'm from Hepburn, Saskatchewan, originally. Meath, Saskatchewan. I'm First Nations. I am Soto, Dakota.
Oh, what's your group you're calling?
I'm from Zegame First Nation down in the Pell Valley.
Zegame,
which means...
you mean Sakame.
Well, yeah, we changed it now. It's back to Zegame, which is what I was told.
Oh, really? I didn't know that. I didn't know it was called Zegame now. Yeah,
I've been Zegame for about a year now. They switched it back.
Really?
But yeah, no, that would be my research. That's where I'm from. So
awesome, man. Awesome. So you grew up here around music and everything?
Yeah, I grew up around here. I played hockey in PA, Shelburne. Yeah. I grew it all up in that area. You know, I spent a lot of my time in sports. You know, I grew up in a adopted family, right? So I was a farm kid. Life took a turn for me. I went in another direction. I went down not a good road.
Hey, man, the thing is that you're here now, and as Emery Burning Grass says, the past is the past.
Exactly.
All right, man. So, number one, tell us why you're here, and then
tell us about your idea. Well, I heard they had food.
Yeah,
that's
the
reason
I'm here.
I thought you
could eat me.
No, just kidding. No, the wife and I, we had an opportunity to take over a business. Like I said, I went down a bad path younger. I spent the last 3 years just kind of making myself better, through drug addiction recovery, counseling, stuff like that.
Yeah.
My wife is an esthetician, which that, for people who don't know what an esthetician is, it's basically somebody who works in a salon, who does nails, waxing, hair, like all, you know, the beautification stuff, you know, that people are looking for.
Yeah.
And so I came here today to learn more about, I guess, this type of thing, you know, trying to get some information on funding, grants, and I guess just, you know, obviously I'm getting the help now, but the help with creating a business proposal. We have one already, but
did you guys make your own?
We made our own, actually. We spent last week, and we did one.
Really?
You know, we sat down and got all the numbers together from, you know, from the person who owns that building, rent costs, energy, everything else like that. Because my wife already does the esthetician stuff, and we already have our own GST numbers and all things. We have a stay supplier that, you know, that supplies us with the things that we need, you know, at a relatively discounted price. So that's allowed us to offer services and products, you know, to the rural communities at a cheaper price than having to travel 30-40 minutes into Saskatoon, you know. Because I wouldn't want to go get a pedicure or a manicure and then lose my relaxation because I had to drive 30-40 minutes home, right? You know,
that's true.
Especially if I got a pedicure. You've got those little things in your toes, and you've got to wear your little sandals, you know. These women got to let their feet dry. They don't want to go 45 minutes in a dirty car to go all the way back home. No. The idea is to get in and out, right? So we want to create that mecca in a small community where people can come and feel pampered and loved and feel like an individual, like you belong. You're part of something, you know. Certainly not a get-rich scheme by any means on our part. We both come from a background of a lot of bad stuff.
Yeah.
So that's adversity. Yeah, there we go. That's a good word, adversity. And that's just put into our mind that, you know, we want to help others in any way that we can.
Yeah.
You know, so we want to provide a service to people that people can afford. You know. I know in Saskatoon, some of the places we've gone to, they're charging well over $100 for a set of nails.
I have no idea.
That is super expensive.
You guys let me know in the comments. I'm literally learning right now.
We're in between the $45 to $75 range, all depending on the type of services that we do. You know,
for the pedicure and manicure.
Yeah, so our pedicures, I believe. The last I checked, we were 55.
You guys do them?
Yeah, we do. Okay. My wife is a
mobile.
We've talked about that too. That might be an idea. And it is something that we've thought of. About reaching out to senior citizen complexes, especially during COVID. I thought, you know, we got a lot of elderly people that come to our store.
Yeah.
Get their nails trimmed. You know,
you guys have a store.
Old guys, right? Get their nails trimmed and everything else like that. I always thought, well, what if we set up a mobile some of these elderly folks, you know? I know, Anne lives down the street, you know? But Anne's also 92 years old. It takes her 45 minutes to walk to the block.
Yeah.
I'll just jump in the car and we'll drive over there and we'll offer that service to her at a premium rate, you know? They get the experience. And also, you know, as an elderly person, so I've been told they enjoy those.
Yeah.
They get a little bit of somebody to visit.
Spend
some time with my
mom and my auntie are older and I know. They're always complaining about their feet, right? And I know for a fact, like, I would pay for that extra money for them to have someone come into the house and do that because they wouldn't want to do it. Eh?
Absolutely.
Yeah, what a great idea.
I'd like to do a mobile if we could and take it to my reserve for a week.
Yeah.
Just set up for a week, take all of our equipment.
Never mind, you go to a powwow.
Or that too, right?
Go to a powwow.
And just say, call people council and say, coming in, offering the service. You know, on this day we have 12 spots open. Philip, this is what you
want.
We get to come in and we get to do this thing. You know, and for some of these women on reserve, for them, that's like hitting the lottery, right?
Yeah.
You know, I don't get to get my nails done, you know, and things like that, right? So,
and if they do want to do it, it's not cheap.
No.
Right? When I ask your ladies to want to do it, man. Wow.
It's a lot of money.
Real, man.
My wife's education was well over 10 grand.
Yeah.
And it was way less than a year of education.
Yeah.
Right? But she's a certified esthetician. Right? She's got all of her She has all of her documentation. She has all of her papers. She has all of those things that she needs, you know, in order to provide that service legitimately in a way.
Yeah.
She's been doing this for over 10 years now. You know, I have over 5 years in retail and sales experience. And part of that project is creating a retail space within that, you know, that we sell product. So, like, if I did your nails, say, you loved it, right? Oh, it's a good color. Well, you know what, bro? I'll sell you that bottle. You know, we left an extra bottle of your product. It was $3 for a bottle, right? Well, people pay $7, $8, sometimes three more.
You guys are beating up the middleman.
Yeah. So, we're going direct to consumer,
yeah.
You know, and cutting out the middle guy. And through that, I mean, it's more work on our end. You know, we got to do a little more research for us to find out what is the best places to, you know, procure product from, you know, so that we can provide it. But we also need to get product that is quality.
Yeah.
At the same time, you know, we don't want to put something on a woman and she comes back 24 hours later and says, look, they all fell off. You know, that's not what we want, right? So it's been tricky. Find that balance of getting quality product that allows these women, you know, these rural communities to feel like they're the same.
You know, I've got, what's the foot one again? The manicure?
Pedicure.
Pedicure is a foot one. So I got a foot one before, I think, 15 years ago.
Yep.
Calgary.
There you go.
I just said, you know what, I'm also going to try one. So I went to Walmart. I was with mine. I'm going to go in here. I went in there and I was like, wow. And I can see why women like dogs. But I can see the shit to having that's massive. And I think, I don't think anyone does it. I've never heard of that
before. We've talked about it. You know, my wife talked about it with a friend, you know, when she was working with for somebody else. But when we made that decision to buy all of our own equipment, $1,000 into this to see what to do. You went to school for this. So, and she's just, you know, she's got a bachelor's in ministry as well, right? So on the wellness and the mental health end of things, you know, she's qualified. Basically, you know, she's a pastor.
Yeah.
You know, so she's qualified. And a lot of times I hear these women talk about my wife. You know, I went to get my nails done today and it was like I had a counselor.
Yeah.
Brings them in, and she just has a way about them, you know, and I can't fully understand it, you know. And so she does that end of things, and then basically the idea is that, you know, this guy, obviously I like to talk, of marketing, right?
You need the
masses.
And you need to learn how to do it, right? You need to learn how to talk, and like sitting down, like.
Like, this isn't really anything new for me. Like, I'll be honest, on the side, like, I've done a lot of public speaking.
Yeah.
Like, truth and reconciliation, super stuff. And then my own story, you know, as a recovering addict as well. In and out of schools, and sharing my story in that way. And so that element of making somebody feel like a real individual, the way I feel in my recovery, that's what we want to bring. You know, through, you know, and that's not saying that you have to have an affliction or anything else like that. You're a regular Joe off the street. Need a little bit of relaxation, money. You know, we're gonna give you that relaxation, and we're gonna listen to you. That's the biggest thing is we're big on listening.
Yeah,
you know, we're not gonna give you blue nails if you said I want pink. Nothing like that.
I like it, man, and it's like it's always giving that human aspect of whatever you're trying to do, right? Humanizing.
Absolutely.
I'm like we're all geared up for not human ideas.
We're in the rat race, right?
Everybody, it's
applying your life in a way that allows you to just be successful and happy in your everyday adventures.
Yeah.
That's and learning how to love yourself, and that's what we try to do. We try to do that every single day so that we give that to other people through communication, through services, even just the simple. You came into our establishment to book an appointment. You know, we want you to leave feeling like, you know, you just had it.
Yeah.
And that's
right. So is it just your wife that does it, or you guys have like?
It's my wife. So the building that we're in right now, actually, there's other people who rent.
Where is this again?
It's in Waldheim, Saskatchewan.
Waldheim, Saskatchewan.
We're about 40 minutes north of But we have a licensed electrolysis there. We have two licensed electrolysis therapists. Like I said,
electrolysis?
Yes, electrolysis. So electrolysis is she takes the little things she has to. Kind of takes all the imperfections out of your skin and everything else like that. Something like that. It is pricey, but my wife offers people. And they're amazing.
They get the massage
and the oil and all that other stuff. And
yeah.
So it's a really, really expensive quality product in order to do that, right? And you get that done. Then you get a little electrolysis done, right? And you look good, right? You know?
Well,
so it's, can
you make that mobile electrolysis thing?
We can, yeah. Because the machine itself isn't very big.
Yeah.
And at the moment, we have somebody who can do it, so we're not really looking into doing that, but it is an idea. You know, if we could do that mobile facial nail electrolysis kind of thing, you know,
yeah.
Or a combination of something like that, you know, in the future, you know, once we get off the ground. Yeah, I mean, we're definitely ideas that are there for the people.
That is so cool, man. Have you learned a lot here while you were here?
I've learned a ton. I've been here. Like I said, so we treated our own business. So we spent a lot of time getting.
Yeah. I feel that, man, because to this day I still haven't done a business for IHOP.
Yeah.
You know, when people used to hear IHOP, still today they don't know what it is.
Yeah.
You know, and I'm getting there. Literally work a full time job for the office.
Yeah.
You know, I have my website, which is a job, and then I created this live podcast.
Okay.
Great attention to my job.
Yeah.
Now it's kind of just turned into this whole thing.
Yeah.
I'm trying to marry my website and this together. But anyway, you wouldn't be able to tell that with this business. Even though they're good to have, I also do have them. They're not just that has.
Absolutely.
Other things happen, right?
Yep. Oh, this is good too. Like, I went on that kick there for a while, right? Right. I did interviews, you know. So
yeah.
This isn't new.
Yeah.
For me, this is pretty.
Yeah.
Pretty comfortable doing these kinds of things, but
do a draw. But going back to your business, all time. So you're here to learn a little bit more how you can get some extra cash.
Yeah.
Pretty
much.
Kind
of help secure the building.
Yeah.
Right. We have all the things that we need to do. Product. Like,
yeah.
The services and everything else like that. It's just a building. Right.
And you want to do in Waldy? That's where you want to be.
Because, like, the reason my wife is here today is because she has clients.
Yeah.
From 9 o'clock to 9 o'clock.
Yeah.
She also has clients tomorrow from 9 o'clock to 8 o'clock.
Yeah.
And then she has a full day from 9 to 5 on Sunday.
Good.
Right. We basically got it to the point now where it's like, if you don't call a weekend before, it's not.
Oh, really?
We're that busy right now. We're doing this spot now. 3 years now. We're always listening. So if anybody else is listening and visits us, if you have experiences you want to share with us, please, you know, check us on our social media, like it's off, right?
Renew Spa?
Renew Spa is where it's at. So that's why I came here. It was just to see if there was grants out there for us that we could,
You've heard of them.
I actually have not.
Really?
I haven't heard about any of these things. This popped up like, okay, so the business was given like offered to us a month and a half ago. And I was kind of like, well, I don't know. This, right?
Yeah.
And then, you know, the algorithms of Facebook. I might have been.
Yeah, I shared it. That was my
okay. Thing. And I looked at it and I was like, that's way too coincidental, you know. And I say, like, well, creator doesn't.
Yeah.
So obviously, that's something that I want to be a part of.
Yeah.
So I signed up. You know, the other lady, her last attend hockey. Some of the treaties this year from that last year. Yeah, found out that was
you playing enough for time?
Yeah. So I yeah, so that allows me to just kinda
that's cool, man.
I like hearing it.
It's funny how we all just wildly connect. Pretty sure how I know Noah. I did a podcast with him actually dealing with my reserve Eric on their how we both know.
Yeah.
So I always wild now. I don't know. It's all wild, man. We're all meant to be where we are now. And I'm glad you're finding out about the team and that.
Yeah. Because
there's so much capital that now.
Things have changed so much, you know, economically for First Nations people. You know, I'm learning a lot about like economical reconciliation at the moment. And just seeing, you know, how doing it in such a way that promotes that reconciliation.
Yeah. You know,
through economics, right? It's not, you can have a job, it's an entry level. You know, it's not that, oh, you're qualified to do this. You know, we're going to give you this job. You know why you're qualified to do this.
Yeah.
There was a guy, part of an Alberta oil company, you know, and talking about how economic reconciliation is what's, you know, these big businesses throwing money into small businesses. It's going to get the attention of the government. And the government's going to look at that and it's going to say, okay, there's something here. If they can see it, why can't I see it? Or if I can't see it, I don't choose to see it. I don't know what it would be. I'm not a politician. I don't know. But what I do know is that I am seeing some forms of economic reconciliation coming through that. And seeing some of these CEOs, we're not looking for a handout. No, you know what we're looking for a handout.
Yeah.
That's what we're looking for, right? And that's why things like this today, I feel, are so important, you know, for young persons, you know, entrepreneurs, and just people in general who want to get a handle. So I'm ecstatic to be here. It's been a wonderful experience. I love it.
No, it's been a really good experience. I gotta go back to the thing that, hey man, it was totally awesome.
Yeah, thanks for having me.
And I enjoy the rest of that.
So we ended off with business. We talked about business to consumer, creating that avatar, right? But we wanted to talk. I wanted to make sure we had a good, wholesome discussion around business to business clients, or especially in our communities, business to government, right? You know, when we talk about First Nations communities and there's a lot of focus on how we are, you know, some of the most underserved communities, you know, in the world in terms of basic infrastructure, everything like that. But what I like to say, I like to turn it on its head, where there's a gap in the community, there's a market opportunity for business, right? So let's just reverse that a bit, right? Where there's gaps, there's an opportunity to create wealth for you and your family in terms of providing a service that the community might need, right? So when you're talking about a business to business or a business to government being your best customer, maybe you're more focused on selling bulk, right? Maybe that's your goal. Maybe your goal is to sell bulk to a grocery store if you have a packaged product. I think you had mentioned in terms of diamond cutting, right? Instead of selling that direct to consumer, maybe your best customer is jewelers who are looking for the most premium diamond cutters around, right? So instead of looking at maybe your business model isn't suited or your main, let's say, revenue stream, your 20% that's going to drive 80% of revenues, your best customer might be that other business, okay? And you want to be able to describe a business or a government, let's say that you're providing workshops, maybe you're providing workshops to communities, right? You want to be able to really describe these businesses or describe these or these governments that you're looking to provide services to. Just how you're creating an avatar for your business to consumer, you want to create that same thing for your business to business or business to government, right? So when you talk about a business to business, what industry are they in, right? They're in fine jewelry, right? Or they're in grocery stores or health food stores, right? And it should be around the customers they attract. So even though that your products might go directly to a consumer, you actually might have to create two profiles. You might have to create the profiles of the customers that will be going to these places, but also where they're going to be going ultimately, right? So for example, let's do the example that we have here, right? So you want to start, well, we'll go through kind of the determinants and the traits you want to start looking for. This is not an exhaustive list, by the way. So industry, you know, what is their specialty? What is their niche? What type of customers do they attract? Maybe you want to create an avatar around the customers that go there. What is their size, right? How many employees do they have? Are they hierarchical type businesses, or are they flat in terms of you being able to access leadership relatively easy or decision makers easy? And most importantly, I would say in terms of this whole kind of determination of business to business and business to government, who are the decision makers within these businesses or within these governments that are all going to make the decision whether they're going to use your product or service, right? So who's the leader that makes the call, whether they're going to purchase your product or service? I start to describe that person. And where are they located, of course? So I have an example here. Cookham's gluten-free bannock premix. All right, so what sets me apart? Well, the Cookham's gluten-free bannock premix, it's a product, it's a shelf product. So I need to start selling, even though I have a customer in mind for the gluten-free premix, it's going to be a customer who has a gluten intolerance. And I want to start thinking about where this customer with a gluten intolerance who wants to enjoy one of the best bannock premixes around, where are they going to go? So I'm going to start thinking, well, they're most likely to go to a local grocery store or maybe a health food store that has some specialty items for gluten intolerance. Or in the grocery store, maybe you want to start talking to the product manager and placing your product and service in the health aisle, like the health food aisle, like the specialty aisle that has, you know, gluten intolerant products, right? So that's the niche of that business. It's bannock premix, but it's for individuals with gluten intolerance, right? So I'm looking for a grocery store, a health food store in the local region, location. It's probably going to be in my home community, surrounding towns, maybe one store in the nearest city I'm going to start out. And maybe I'm mainly going to focus on stores in southern Saskatchewan first. So I'm going to start researching. I'm going to go to Saskatchewan Start Institute. I'm going to start finding these locations, doing my own research. And the most important thing you want to start doing is figuring out who is the decision maker, who is going to be buying your product and service, who owns the store. Who's the store manager? Who's the product manager, right? Because that's the individual within that organization that you're ultimately going to have to position your product to. So let's do an exercise where I create a theoretical scenario where I create an avatar, right? So in terms of my sales and marketing activities, I know of a grocery store. I'm going to first go to the grocery store in my home community. I know on average, just based on what I saw in terms of the community audit recently, I know that the grocery store makes around 250K in sales a year, let's say. I know the staff pretty well. I know there's around 5 to 10 staff, and I know it's a for-profit business, which might make sense. Like if you're dealing with non-for-profits, you might have a different sales approach than if you're focusing on a for-profit business, right? But the most important thing is that I'm going to go to our local grocery store. Let's say Cowessess First Nation grocery store. I know that they have around 10 staff. I know Jim. Jim is the store manager. And so what my goal is I'm going to speak to Jim and I'm going to position my Cookham's gluten-free bannock premix. And I'm going to ask if we can, if they're willing to buy a bulk order of that and position it within their store and doing a test. Or I'm going to say, hey, can I sample my product in your store for a day and start to get some customer feedback to see if it'll land? Right. So it's really important that you start to build out these avatars with these target markets. So that's what we're going to do next. We're going to spend like about 5 minutes kind of thinking. I want you to create a story. So take 5 minutes to create a story around your best customer. And then we're going to get everyone to share the story. We're going to take at least, you know, we're going to take around this next little block here. We'll take around 15 minutes to do this. So start at 5 minutes, create your story of your best customer. And then if you want to work with everyone around the group, if you need some help, do that. But take some time to create your best customer. And then we're going to have someone come up here and share their story. So, and when you're talking about your best customer, be specific. Where do they live? Who do they trust? Remember the story about the doula. What are their values? What do they do? Where can you find them in groups? So create that avatar, whether it's a business or whether it's a direct customer. If you're dealing with a community, you know, maybe you're focusing on health and wellness. Well, if you're dealing with the community, then you need to be focused on that. So who's the counselor that's overseeing the health and wellness aspect of the community? Who has that portfolio? Who's the decision maker there? Maybe there's a subsidiary organization that's focusing on that. Maybe you have to go to them first. Right? So create that story. So learn from discussions and questions and make notes on your validation map for your best target market. And we'll return in about, let's say 5 minutes. Let's get that story right now. So work on your story, write a little story, start, give them a name. So Susanna Lee, 25, going to university, her third year, she just started yoga in the surrounding area. And she needs some additional clothing for the yoga class because she's really loving it and she's finding that she has to wash her clothes every day. So that's her behavior, right? So create that story.
All right, we're just do their thing right now, you guys. And, nice on the spot again. Don't want him getting too mad. So, Tyson, tell us really quick what you've learned so far today. This partnership that was put on by Seep. He's all excited right now. He won a couple of prizes. I'm just a verbal guy.
Okay, go ahead. Go ahead.
You have lots to say, man. You got to just learn to bring it out and express. Because EAL is actually up and coming, and just like how schools are starting to teach lab-based, like big thing now. EAL, like you said, the horse spirit, you bring that into to the play with all the students, right? And teach everyone something. It's like a much needed thing in society, you know, especially after COVID, and, you know, everyone seems to have a lot of anxiety and mental health issues. So, having that horse spirit that you know so much about, bring it into the school system to help, you know, help students at home. Yeah, it's a lot of anxiety. Right now, I have some talking on the students. Yeah. And that's where you channel data, the horse spirit, right? I have to bring it to calm you down. It's a challenge. But I'm really on.
That startup.
I'm actually going to put her on a podcast. So you guys know, I'm going to, some of the vendors that were here, I'm going to put them on a podcast and then talk more. Yeah, I'd like to go there. Yeah. So especially, you're going to have to do Chief Future Preacher, that startup.
Oh, yeah, like,
Yeah. But you want to do all three because Seep is basically the one you're going to be getting money from. You know, or future entrepreneur.
because there's another one where whole community futures. I did get a bag, but the woman one. There's this lady here. What's this lady? That's I didn't get a chance to talk to anyone. She was from what's she doing? She's doing the operation. Oh, okay. You know, with these kind of things, man, they're so needed, right, to bring that information out for future indigenous entrepreneurs, especially entrepreneurs such as myself that have already been in the game. But, you know, it's always nice to have someone that I can put a future return. And it's actually while I was here, they're just either going to call to possibly add on to my business. It was just a random call.
As long as you're not deciding on where exactly. There. This thing's always this audio. I'm glad I'm understanding this audio more. Cause these things, because they're new, is affecting my audio. Not like through this, but it's just interacting with the button somehow, messing it up. Anyway, there you guys go, Seif and Futurepreneur helping people that have already been in entrepreneurship game, and also newcomers that are coming up and want to learn more about it. As you just seen that, what was this other guy's name here? Aaron. Yeah. To, you know, him, and then to Tyson, and there's a croup here. There's a journeyman welder here that's doing a business, and I mean, all sorts here, all ages. And, you know, to have some of the, you know, Noah here, I'll show you right here, Noah. This guy to help you out, you know, he's from Futurepreneur. I'm going to put his information here as well. That's how you can get a hold of him, Noah Wilson, nwilson at futurepreneur.ca. And, you know, just to hear everything he's got and what they can do. And also contact Seif, Saskatchewan Indian Equity Foundation, there as well. I don't have their information here, but I will. Just Google that. SIEF, Saskatchewan Indian Equity Foundation. I forget what their website is, but we'll find it soon. And yeah, you guys, there's just so much information out there. And, you know, and I think they're going to do something like this next summer, they were saying, in Saskatoon. Okay, it's if you guys want to get a hold of them, call 306-955-4550. 955-4550, and that's Seif, Saskatchewan Indian Equity Foundation, and they've helped hundreds, if not thousands, Indigenous entrepreneurs to get money for their business. And Trista Piwapasconius from Cooperative. Oh, I've talked to this girl before, and I didn't know that was her. Huh. Small world.
Yeah, they're doing that trail ride in Gymkhana.
Yeah. Oh, in Little Pine.
Yeah, they start tomorrow, and then the Gymkhana, I think, is on Saturday.
Yeah. There's a lot out there, you guys. And, you know, one of the ideas I wanted to do is I want to really keep doing this live thing, and I really want to promote more Indigenous events. But sometimes a lot of these committees don't have the money to, you know, bring you in, right? What I want to try, dude, I'm going to put it out to universe, is go out there and get sponsorship. You know, say these big companies and say, listen, sponsor me for these 10 lives. So I can just go to these companies or to these events and say, listen, you don't have to pay me. Just give me a spot. I'll go live. Right?
That'd be cool.
See?
Especially with a lot of your setup, because you'll have that drone.
Yeah, have the drone. Camera,
that would be awesome.
Yeah, I mean, just to cool, because there's us as Indigenous people, we do so much, right? There's a lot of stuff that, obviously, we can't show some stuff like the, you know, the cultural aspect, but I'm talking about the events, like these events, hockey, a lot of those conferences as well. There's a lot of knowledge there that we could be showcasing, and also all aspects, you know, even businesses. I just got possibly invited to go to Big River on September 6th to the grand opening of the Jim Nielsen School and Arena, I think it is.
Okay.
And then also, I was here today, got invited possibly to go to do something at the U of S for ITEP. So, I mean, you know, it's there, the option's there. So, I think we're going to go back to Noah here.
We're near the end of our workshop today. So, I'm going to get two people in the room to give me a story around their avatar that they can speak to. Okay. So, who wants to go first? Who's worked on their story? Who wants to try it out? Don't jump up at the same time, everyone. Just looking at the grounds. Everyone's just like, oh, not me. Who wants to give it a go? Just two. I won't extend it too much longer. Who hasn't gone yet? Try it out. Yes! Woo! All right, everyone, give her a round of applause. It's not easy. We're going to do two, and then we'll move on. So, yeah, come up. And what was your name? Dana Morasti. Everyone give Dana a round of applause. This isn't easy stuff, right? Like, and we're going to learn a lot from her as well. So give her a warm welcome.
Hello. So my, I guess, business plan goal is a mobile dental clinic. I'm a dental hygienist by trade, but in the future, I plan on going to therapy. So, but my target client is someone who struggles to make appointments, people who live in rural communities or reservations, people who don't have a dental home, homeless, vehicle-less, seniors, people who are mobility challenged, daycares, school, and low-income people.
Great, on.
So that was really great because we understood exactly which areas that we're going to be finding these individuals. We understand, you know, what are some of the life experiences and demographics that we're looking to serve. And one of the best things that you mentioned there was the problems, you know, because every business has is here to solve a problem at the end of the day. So you're outlining where your product and service and your business is going to be solving the job and the problem of those clients there. So I really like that pitch. So everyone give her another round of applause. We learned a lot from there because, you know, it's important to understand which jobs our businesses are solving for our potential clients. The only thing I would say is try to like narrow in on your best customer. So figure out one that's going to be that one that returning client or that one that you can count on consistently. You've had a couple, but I would say even create a story around it. Remember when I was talking about Susie Lee and I created that story, try to build one story around that, but you can have several client customer segments and you did a really excellent job around building out the problems that you're solving for them. So we have time for one more. Does anyone want to jump in? Broke the ice. Sure. Absolutely. Nathan, the one and only Nathan. Let's include him up here. Thanks for all your work that you've done for us today.
All right. Thank you. My name is Nathan Arias from Red Pheasant First Nation, same reserve as Tyson over here. He actually came up with me, gave me 20 for gas. I said, okay, let's go. But here we are. Anyway, this is my company, iops.ca. And I'm striving to become the number one Indigenous job board within Canada. And you're wondering, well, how does that job board have anything to do with what me sitting over there? I created a podcast to bring attention to my website. The podcast started a life of its own. I've actually had Noah on my podcast. This is actually the first time I met him, but we've met before online, and I did a podcast with him. Anyway, I started with my cell phone, literally walked up to random Indigenous people in Saskatoon when you could start going live, I think around 2016. And I said, hey, you want to go live? Do you do a business or anything? He's like, one person actually, everyone said no, but this one guy said, yeah, actually, I draw online. I said, cool, man. I'll send you a link tonight. He's like, yeah. So that's how my first podcast started with my cell phone. Fast forward to now, I'm doing podcasts. I've actually helped people podcast. I don't know if you guys heard of Foxing Around with Raymond and River. Pretty big Indigenous podcast. Anyway, I helped them and Dene Yate podcast. Anyway, this is where I am now. I'm doing live events. I started just randomly. I went to a hockey game last year in North Balfour, and then there's a big playoff game, and I said, I gotta broadcast this because there is, how many people from our reserve that were playing in Miota? I don't know. There was like 8 Indigenous hockey players on each side, and it was like the finale. So I just put online, how do I get broadcast this? Like, who do I talk to, right? Anyway, somebody messaged me and they gave me some connections. Anyway, I just went up there to the booth. I went live and I called my buddy Cal Arcan. I don't know if you guys know Cal, but I called him. I said, hey, we're not getting paid for this. Get over here. I think I might be onto something. And he came. We killed it. We had like probably like 2,000 viewers through the whole game. And now we're, you know, I did 3 or 4 powwows this summer. You know, I did a couple of youth conferences, you know, and it's at the same time while I'm doing all this. So this little side hustle I was doing here that I didn't even know I was going to do turned into something now. Now I have something going with this podcast. And at the same time, I have my job, my website here. So now what I'm telling myself is I need to find a way to marry them together. And I was remembering you were saying, Kevin. One of the entrepreneurs on your thing. Kendall. And how you're a serial entrepreneur. Like, it just starts going. Like, if once you get into a thing and a little thing starts and you just go. Anyway, I'm not going to talk anymore. You guys, entrepreneurship is so awesome. Having C, Futurepreneur, SK. Sorry, what did they win? Yeah, them. And, you know, sorry. I've been focusing on this. I'm trying to let you go. But you guys, being an entrepreneur is probably one of the greatest things you can ever do, you know, for yourself, because there's just, I don't know, there's so much opportunity and you meet great people like Noah and Cree and my bro Tyson. Bye.
So, you know, his best customers are Indigenous social innovators who are innovating the ways that we're interacting with community. So the last thing we're going to wrap up on, and give a round of applause for Nathan and all the support doing the live stream again today. He's been a huge help for us and connecting with us as a broader community. So give Nathan a round of applause for that too. So the last thing we're going to talk about is your value proposition. So that's your last section of your validation map. Okay. And we talked about this quite a bit. And so what is your promise key benefit to customers? So we talked about convenience. We talked about, if you look here, reduces pain, minimizes risk. So having a highly credible, strong credentials, or maybe having a guarantee. So the management behind there, maybe it's quality, the higher grade and healthier service. Maybe it's the experience of your culture camp, right? You know, maybe it saves you time. Maybe it saves you money. It's socially responsible. But the thing you need to focus on is you only really need one. And sometimes you only need to be 15 to 20% better or different than your customers. So you don't have to be 100% different to them, but you need to have a differentiating factor to them. And remember when I said create a compelling value focused on quality or service. So don't sell on price. If like, don't position your business just based on price, because this helps you safeguard against competition and it gives you something else to talk about with customers other than price. So, and the reason why is if you're selling on price, like unless you have what's called economies of scale and you have, let's say, amazing connections to suppliers, and these are more established business kind of advantages, it's a race to the bottom, right? You don't want to undervalue your services. So make sure you're positioning yourself with one key value based on quality or service experience. Could be more innovative. Remember I mentioned, you know, what sets this, you know, there's beaded lanyards, right? Beaded lanyards every market you go to. But if there is a value proposition that you could tell me that I'll sell you this beaded lanyard and it won't fray for 2 years, you bet your bottom dollar I'm getting your beaded lanyard, because it has that quality or innovation aspect to it that other beaded lanyards have. Because this one, I've had a problem and you're solving it because you've created a beaded lanyard that doesn't fray because of a beading technique that you've done. Okay. You want to write down that value proposition and start working through it on your validation map there. Another thing you want to focus on with your value proposition, and we mentioned this today, is a SWOT analysis. And what that means is you look at your strength, weaknesses, opportunities, and threats. So focus on looking at your business first. And when you start doing your market research, start comparing it against competitors. So internal, what are your strengths? What do you do well? What makes you unique? What experience do you have? You know, what makes you better than the competition internally, right? So that's the S in SWOT. Internal, what is your weaknesses? Maybe you don't have an established brand yet. You know, what parts of your businesses are maybe not profitable yet? Where do you need further experience? Maybe your weaknesses is you don't have a staff of 5 to 10 employees and your nearest competition does. That could be a weakness, okay? What are opportunities, right? So when we talk about economic development in our communities, or if you look at your opportunities in a community, because our communities are historically underserved in a lot of crucial elements and areas, that's an opportunity to create a business, right? That's external to you. What can enhance your business? Is it technology? Maybe there's an opportunity to create more efficiencies with your business. Maybe there's a piece of equipment that you can gather that would set you apart from the competition. Is there new customers that haven't been reached yet? We talked about how there's an opportunity to take advantage of the market that you mentioned, that there's no one else there. That's a huge opportunity that you want to look at. Where is the nearest competitor in relationship to that? And then what are your threats? So, you know, is your barrier to entry in terms of launching your business low? Meaning, I mean, let's say that you maybe your threat in terms of your innovative beading lanyard business is that another beater figures out how you did it. That's a threat. How are you going to insulate yourself from that? Or how are you going to be the first mover to the market in terms of establishing your brand? You know, what's going on in the economy and industry? You know, if you talk about threats, COVID-19 and the pandemic is one of the best examples of potential threats that could happen to your business. So if your business is based on service, like highly interactive things, that could be a threat to your business. How are you going to be able to position yourself and pivot if something was to severely impact your business, right? In terms of being able to work with clients one-on-one. And what obstacles do you face in terms of logistics? So we can dive into this, and I mean, you know, you're not going to solve this all today, but what I want you to write in your value proposition section in terms of a gap is what is your SWOT analysis? Because I guarantee you that very few of you have done a SWOT analysis yet. And if you have done a SWOT analysis for your business, I want you to create another gap is do a SWOT analysis for at least 2 to 3 other competitors. So you're going to do the same exercise for a competitor and have at least 2 to 3 there. And that's going to be important in terms of your business plan. When we look at Futurepreneur business plans, this is one of the most important areas because it shows us that you've done your research in comparison to the business. And the reason why this is going to help you, it's going to see where you fit in your gap. Where niche do you fit in the market? What is your value proposition? By looking at the strength, weaknesses, opportunities, and threats of your business in relation to other competitors, you're going to be able to find out what sets you apart. And that's what the essence of a value proposition is about. All right. Yeah. So, in terms of who is my best customer, is it B2C or B2B? You know, how many potential customers have I interviewed locally? Where can I find them locally? Have I pitched my idea to 10 people? you know, where can I find out more? Where can people find out more about my business? You have an Insta, Facebook, website, strategic clients. So if you don't have any of those things yet, fill those in as a gap in terms of your target market and value proposition. Have you done a survey? Surveys are powerful tools. Use Facebook polls. Put it into a Facebook group. Use SurveyMonkey to create a survey that you can put out online. What is my industry, and have I requested a secondary market research request yet? You know, who are my competitors? Looking into that. If you don't know who your competitors are, put who are my competitors in your value proposition. Put a gap there, right? And have you made a sale yet? If you haven't made a sale, try to make a sale, right? You're talking about making sales already. Like, see if there's any interest in what you're doing. So we have the gaps all around, right? And we're going to do the same thing in terms of committing to action. So by the end of your validation map, you should have details, you should have gaps that are circles, and then you should have action items, right? So if we look in the value proposition section there, one of the gaps that we have identified is haven't taught enough people to know yet. So they're not sure what their value proposition is. So what they're going to do is they're going to interview 20 parents to determine their value proposition by January 21st. So part of that activity that they're going to do is interviewing people, right? That's an action item. You know, for your target market, need to validate need and competition in the area. All right. So what they're going to do is they're going to interview 20 moms with kids in tutoring by January 1st. One of the other gaps is they have no connections to mom groups. So maybe you're going to find three support groups for mothers online by X amount of date. And then you're going to create an action item around that. Okay. So this is how your validation map should look like. And you should have an action item for each area. You don't have to go crazy. Like, start working through one or two a week in each area, and you're going to be surprised how much you can get done by taking this approach. Okay. Does anyone have any questions related to value proposition or target market right now? So this is a good example here for the target client, right? So your end user is youth. It's kids in grades 4 to 6, right? They're going to be high achievers. Maybe they need learning assistance. But your end users, so the people who are going to be using your products and services, might not be the ones who are ultimately purchasing it from you. So what I mean by that is that you're going to be all of your materials, all of your curriculum is for kids in grades 4 to 6. But the individuals that you're ultimately going to need to sell to, your target clients, are mothers of the kids. So mid-30s, Brentwood area, disposable income. You know, you might be selling diamonds in a jewelry store, but you need to be so your end user might be someone who's looking for these luxury quality, you know, locally sourced diamonds, but your ultimate seller is going to be a jewelry store, right? And then where are you going to find them in groups? So, you know, mom Facebook groups, yoga classes, the doula classes, if they're expecting mothers, we talked about this, okay? So start to build that story around them. Does anyone have any questions? Online or otherwise. All right. So this has been a long day. I really appreciate everyone's time. So next steps, what I want everyone to do is start practicing your pitch. All of these four quadrants, if we remember today, earlier today, when we go back here, when we go all the way back, when we look at the pitch, when we started off today, I got you all to have a baseline pitch. Who are you? Right? That's your credibility section. What do people get? Your product and service, right? Who specifically loves it? Your best customer. And what's one awesome thing about it? Your value proposition. So the whole document you have in front of you is going to help you really refine your pitch going forward. And that's how that four quadrants really helped you today. We got a baseline. We showed you how hard it is to actually pitch. And now you have an idea of how to refine it, work on it, keep pitching. So the
last thing I'll say is make sure that you sign up on Futurepreneur Online. So in order to get in contact with me, no matter where you are in Saskatchewan, you just go register on our online website. And
I'll reach out to you once you've registered. Okay. And we'll start the relationship there. We also have a Rock My Business Plan series that's starting in That's starting this month. So if you go onto our Futurepreneur website or you just Google Rock My Business Series, you're going to be able to do a Rock My Business Idea Workshop, a Rock My Business Plan Workshop, and a Rock My Cash Flow Workshop. So I really recommend you do that. The Rock My Business Idea Workshop was similar today, but definitely take advantage of that. And let's please connect. So I just want to say Chi Miigwech Ekwesani to everyone who joined today. Let's give a round of applause again to everyone in the room. We just spent literally from 9 a.m. till a little over 3:40 today. You all are still here. You all took that first step towards building out your business plan. I'd like to thank Seif again for hosting this amazing workshop. Thanks to the Prince Albert Inn for hosting us. Thanks to Nathan and everyone at IOPS for the live stream. Thanks for everyone joining us online. Chi Miigwech to everyone. Don't be a stranger and keep it moving. Hopefully this energized everyone today. And just remember, the documents you're leaving away today is your first step to building out a strong business plan. And don't let this, it can be overwhelming at times. But just keep in mind of the energy and the stories we told today, and just really appreciate everyone who came by. So Chi Miigwech, everyone, please take care. Reach out to me, go onto the Futurepreneur website, sign up, and then I will be reaching out to you. So Chi Miigwech, everyone, thank you so much. Safe travels home.
All right, you guys, there you guys go. That is it. And tune in for the next one, for the next event, whatever I'm broadcasting. You can see me broadcast powwows and hockey games and sporting events on my page, iops.ca goes live with that. Don't forget to check out iops.ca as we're striving to become the number one Indigenous job board within Canada. That's it. Thank you for everything. We'll see you at the next.